If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode,
this is it.
Mind Pump. We had some fun conversation for about 25 minutes. We talk about Adam's tincture trouble.
Wow.
It was, it's pretty fucking hilarious.
You went to the moon and back.
Yeah, it was the cannabis fiasco.
Please don't tell anybody.
Then we talked about Justin's meat bar.
Yeah. God, I love them meat bars.
That he bought from Thrive Market. By the way, if you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump and enter the code mindpump, you will get some pretty awesome stuff. You get a free month and you get like $60 that goes towards your first three orders. So it's like free food, all organic, non-GMO stuff. It's great. I also mentioned Four Sigmatic Reishi in this episode. If you go to Four Sigmatic, that's FourSigmatic.com/mindpump, enter the code mindpump at checkout, you'll get a discount on their products. Then we get into the questions. First question was, how do you know if you have a damaged metabolism? Or some people will call it adrenal fatigue or HPA axis dysfunction or just a really slow metabolism. How do you know? Then we give our opinions on DHT blockers like finasteride. These are drugs that stop or help you prevent you from going bald. I guess people have been DMing Adam quite a bit about this. So
our teasing has turned into DMs.
We talk about it. Yeah. Then we have someone who asked us the question, if we have any advice for them because they found out their significant other has taken steroids in the past and is probably going to continue to take them. Of course, Mind Pump is a fitness podcast, but we're also experts in relationships.
Why are they hiding things from you?
Finally, we get kind of political, maybe. We touched the third rail a little bit. Somebody asked us what our stance was on cattle being the biggest threat to the climate and if we would consider going vegetarian for our future.
I can't imagine a lot of people are going to be happy with this.
Cheeseburgers are delicious. Finally, Adam, what is today?
It's the final day.
It's the final day for one of our favorite promotions ever. Pretty much if you enroll in any of our programs or bundles, you will get something for free. You're either going to get MAPS Prime for free, or you're going to get MAPS Prime Pro for free, or you're going to get MAPS Performance for free. This includes our super bundle, which is 1 year of exercise programming all planned out for you. If you enroll in that, we're going to give you MAPS Prime Pro for free in that particular one right
there. That's the hookup.
You can find out about all of this. All you got to do is go to mindpumpmedia.com.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Is there anybody in there?
Oh my God, dude.
Didn't not if you Adele do a hello? Was that her song? Hello.
She does too.
Hello.
Yeah.
I saw her in concert.
You haven't sang in a long time,
I don't
Adam.
Know what. What does Adele sound like, Adam? I don't want to hear this.
Yeah. I don't know what song you're talking about.
She is not going to be the first person that I try to do.
Come on, man. That would be epic.
No.
You haven't sang a song for us in a while.
That's just because I can't.
Well, you knew that before. You didn't stop
yeah,
you.
Yeah, but, you know, you try
it's,
hard.
It's our fault, Justin.
Yeah, I know.
Because I think up until, you know, Mind Pump, Adam thought he wasn't as bad as he is.
We should have encouraged him more.
And we should have lied the whole time because we could have got so much singing at him.
It would have never worked, bro. There's no like fooling me into thinking when I sing good. It's like, maybe I do sound good.
Really?
Guys keep telling me I sound good.
When you listen to the podcast where you did sing, do you think to yourself like, oh shit, or do you think like, it's not as bad as I thought?
No, I'm every bit as bad as I've ever. I remember I went to church my whole life as a kid growing up, and so I heard myself singing in church, dude. It was bad.
It was pretty bad.
Yeah, yeah. So I hummed for half of my life.
Did you really?
Mom, I ain't singing anymore. It's bad.
No way.
Like, yeah, I'm pissing off the people.
Amazing Grace.
Exactly. Yeah, it's all bad. It's all bad.
Dude, so you know, we're doing our work, and we typically message each other after work because we're still working on things and stuff. And Adam, all of a sudden, like 5 p.m., gone. And we had some important shit to talk about. Yeah. Adam's fucking gone.
Well, he was there for a minute, and then it just no response.
Like halfway through the text, he's gone. Right?
I couldn't.
So you come in. You come in this morning. You come in today, and I want you to share the story of why you fucking disappeared.
Before we completely let me back up a little bit. So one of the things that Mind Pump is exploring right now is the possibilities of us taking on a cannabis sponsor. Where we've talked about marijuana plenty of times on the show. We're all pretty much pro cannabis. And so since I've kind of announced that and said that, I've had a plethora of cannabis people that are sending us stuff.
Samples.
Yeah, samples.
And these are legal. These are legal, state legal companies.
It's awesome. You know, I appreciate that. So much love to everybody that's been sending the love. And I got one of these, and I don't think I'm going to shout out the name because I don't know.
No, it's probably not
a good idea.
Just say what kind of product it was.
Yeah, so it was a tincture, right? And
it came in a little spray bottle.
Little tiny little spray bottle. And I'll give everybody a little background that, so sometimes what we'll do is I'll have a little chocolate ball that's 5 milligrams of cannabis. It's a nice
set. At most.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Takes the edge off. It's like having a glass of wine. That's what it feels like to me. It's not, I don't feel high. It doesn't get me, I can function completely fine.
No, that's a normal dose for, right. I mean, you know, for people, 2 to 5 milligrams.
Then if I'm trying to have some fun and I'm at home and I don't have to be driving any vehicles and I'm just watching shows or what like that, I may push it up to 10 milligrams. 10 milligrams, I definitely feel high from that.
Good science fiction movie to watch. Yeah.
So never do I want to feel like that when we're at work, right? So,
you're looking for a low, mild.
Right. So right before we get on the air yesterday, I'm like looking for something and I realized that I couldn't find the chocolate balls that we have laying around here, the cannabis chocolate balls that we always have. And so I grab this guy's tinctures and I look at it and it says the dosage is like 0.14. And I'm like, well, that's not very much. I'm thinking 0.14, it's not quite one. I probably want 5 or so milligrams. So I spray it in my mouth like 4 or 5 times.
Now, we need to be like, for people who don't know, tinctures are never very strong.
Yeah. They're
like, if you get a tincture, typically you could fill up a dropper full and it's going to be like 2 milligrams of THC at most. I mean, they're typically weak.
Right. Yeah. People have to remember too that
you have experience.
Yeah. I have a lot of experience around this stuff for a long time. So I've taken lots of tinctures before. And just like Sal said, typically, you know, you don't really feel that much of them. And it takes quite a few because it's a spray. Like it's a little mouse.
It's not even a dropper full.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not
Thank
exactly,
God.
Yeah. It's not even a dropper
full. Was it a dropper full?
So I spray 4 or 5 on there. We record the podcast. I'm fine. And then maybe like an hour or so, I had to leave early because I had to go drop off the Denali to go get new tires. And the funny part was I get there and one of my buddy owns the place and I'm talking to him. Katrina's meeting me there to pick me up. And she's calling me on my phone and she must be out in the parking lot. And she's like, what's taking you so long? I'm like, oh, sorry. I just got caught talking to my buddy. And
Number one.
Right. I get in the car. Yeah, right. Rambling, right? Totally. Yeah. So I get in the car with her and she's like, what took you so long? I'm like, oh, you know, I'm just catching up. You know, we haven't talked in a long time, this and that. I'm like, but man, he seems like he's on one. And she's like, what do you mean? I'm like, I don't know. He just seemed off to me and just seemed kind of weird and antsy. He seemed like he was on something. I wonder what's going on with my boy. I'll have to reach out to him later on and see how he's doing. And she's like, well, did you smoke or anything? And I'm like, No. I had like this tincture edible thing, but I'm fine. I'm not. She's like, well, you look a little high, and I go, really? Like you think? And she's like, yeah, maybe it was you. And I'm like, yeah.
And then her head morphed into a lizard.
So we just kind of, laugh it off, right? You. So and then we drive home. This is now like 2 hours, 3 hours in, and typically, like you know, that's about when these things should be setting in. And I'm sitting on the couch, and she's cooking dinner, and I go, I don't feel good. She's like, what's wrong? And I'm like, I don't know. I feel kind of nauseous and I feel really high right now. And she comes over, look at me and stuff like that. She goes, you getting sick again? I'm like, no, I don't feel that kind of sick. I feel like drunk, like weird. And so I'm kind of sitting there and she gets done with dinner. We're sitting down eating. And then I'm standing up kind of pacing in the living room and she's like, what's wrong with you? And I'm like, can we go for a walk? And she's like, okay, like right now? And she was like working and I was like, yeah. And so she puts the computer down. And we go take a walk, right? And we're walking.
Damn, and walk us off.
Yeah, well, no, that's exactly how I felt. And which, by the way, I think it's such a natural thing. Like, you know, you get drunk, trying to wear something out of your system, right? Like, I could tell my body was just like you
water
need to,
and walk.
You need
all
to
the
move,
W's.
You need to move because.
And a wink.
Sitting still was making me feel really bad. And so we go walk, and she's like, I'm going to go next door real quick. I'll be right back. And I was like, okay, I'll sit down after our walk. And I felt a little bit better after the walk, but as soon as I sat down again, got like fucking the room starts spinning. And so I go upstairs and I text her. I'm like, when you come home, I'm in bed. And it was like 5 o'clock. And you guys were texting back and forth our group thread. And it got to the point where I couldn't read anymore. I'd be like looking at the phone and like everything was spinning. And I'm like, dude, this is awful.
Were you like seeing shit?
I wasn't seeing things. I felt really drunk is what I felt like. So long story short, I was completely hammered and smashed. I went to bed at 5 o'clock. Katrina was constantly nursing me all night long. She totally took advantage of me that night too. I told her that afterwards. And I'm like, man, I was out of it, and you totally took advantage of me last night. She's like, well, you were into it.
You got to work it out,
right? Yeah. Yeah. So
she took photos.
Right, yeah. Right. So morning time come in the morning, and I'm like, man, I need to go. What did I take? So I go in and I tell the boys this morning.
So hold on. So you went to sleep at 5.
Yeah.
And you slept till the next day.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Hard.
And you're somebody that doesn't. You have trouble sleeping. A lot of times.
I get up multiple times.
So you were
professional in this arena.
I did. You would think that, right?
Yeah. So thank God it wasn't Justin.
I know, right?
Oh my God.
I would have been in another dimension. Yeah. Like, I would have been so scared.
You would have come up with one of your ideas.
Well, yeah. At one point,
there have been plenty of analogies to come after that.
Yeah. I got up to go to the restroom one time in the middle of the night. I did wake up like at 1 or 2. And I mean, I was like stumbling all over the floor. And Katrina woke Katrina up. Are you okay? And I'm like, yeah, no, I'm just having a hard time walking. Like I had a hard time keeping my balance going to the restroom. Sure, I pissed all over my floor in the morning, in the middle of the night and stuff like that. So I get up and I feel okay. Like I feel like I definitely had a long night of drinking or partying. And then that's when I came here to the studio.
So he comes in and we're talking and he's like, dude, he goes, I was fucked up last night. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, I don't know how much THC was in that spray. It must have been a lot. So I grab the bottle and I read the, and it's confusing as fuck. This is the problem, is that it's not clear. It doesn't tell you how much is in it per spray. It literally says how much total THC there is in there per 100 milliliters, and then it tells you how many milliliters is in a spray, and so you have to do the math.
Yeah, it's like,
and I'm so asking.
I'm a pretty good math guy.
Well, you're asking stoners. Like, this is the funny part. Like, those are the last motherfuckers
you want to be great with numbers.
Yeah, and plus, you know, it's a tincture. Like, those are never strong. So me and Adam are trying to figure out the math. And remember, 5 milligrams is considered a dose. 10 milligrams,
I'm high.
It's a strong dose.
Yeah.
20 milligrams is an uncomfortable, paranoid dose. That's like if I did 20 milligrams,
if you're a heavy,
I would be very unhappy.
Well, most of your like heavy, heavy smokers or someone who would consider themselves like fucking a stoner would take that much.
Yeah,
would
take maybe
20, 25,
maybe right. Adam did 70 milligrams of THC without realizing it, and I think you were
into the darkness.
I think you were still high the next day because when you came in, you were normal. It wasn't like you were whatever, but you had that side of you.
Well, I was giggly, and then the whole day I was just kind of in a haze a little bit. So I definitely have no desire to smoke weed right now for a while. You know, it's like getting really hung over from drinking. You're like, oh, I don't want to drink for
Thank
a while.
Thank God it's that THC is not, that you have to take like thousands and thousands of milligrams in order to get.
Hurt. Right. Thank God I was lucky that right afterwards I went straight over to drop the tires off and Katrina met me there to pick me up, because had I stayed here and been a full day at work and then tried to drive home, that would have been scary.
That would have, imagine if it was like a situation where you did a little bit and you're like, oh, later I got to have that meeting, wear off by then.
So,
and then you're in a meeting and it hits you.
When
it,
I like first, I don't know if I ever shared this story on Mind Pump, but when we first, this was back when I was still running Santa Teresa and Caudill Gym for 24 Hour Fitness. I was managing there and I was transitioning out. So I was working there. I had my boot camp business that was running, and then I was also starting the cannabis clubs. So I was working the cannabis clubs, I'd be going back and forth between all these things. And I remember one day we had this vendor come in. It was right when we first started, and he's like, he brought me these drinks, and they were teas. And he was like, these are just real mellow, and they're sativa, and so you should feel up. It's not, and I was just learning about cannabis at this point, and this was my first bad experience of like trying stuff without, you know, like carefully easing my way in. And I drank this tea because he kept selling me on how it's for the daytime and that you'll feel good because it's a sativa. And then I had to go run a meeting next door at the gym at 24 Hour Fitness like 2 hours later, and I was fucking high. I was so paranoid and freaked out. I have no idea what came out of my mouth up there. And like, thank God it was doing something that I've done for so long and I feel comfortable talking about fitness.
Yeah.
But I don't even know how it went down.
Dude, that's the worst feeling.
I was so scared.
That happened to me once when I had my studio. I was training clients and one of my friends brought, you know, some edibles in, and I have a very low tolerance. I just do. I always have. My body reacts very strongly, and you know, I tend to titrate it. And this is right around the time when I started using it for my gut issues. So I was super low tolerance. So this friend of mine brings this edible, and she's like, "Okay, this is a low dose." And so she gives me this piece, and so to be safe, I ate like 2/3 of the low dose. So I thought for sure I'll be okay. And I just want to see how I feel. And she's like, "You probably won't feel anything." And she's like assuring me, like, "You're probably not going to feel anything." So I'm like, okay, cool. So I eat it and I'm training clients. And I make the cardinal mistake that everybody makes once, which is I wait and I don't feel it.
So you take another one.
So I take more.
God, yeah.
So I wait. I don't feel anything. It's like an hour later.
Bad move.
It's like an hour later. So I'm like, I'll take twice the dose. I don't feel anything. So here we go. No joke, 5 minutes after I took it, the second dose, I start to feel the first dose, and I realize the mistake I made.
Yeah, it's too late.
I'm like,
this is going to get so worse.
I'm like, this is too fast to feel that second dose. I'm like, oh, shit, that's the first dose.
Yeah.
And I had a full fucking day, dude. I had like 8 clients left. I used to train 10 clients in a day sometimes. Yeah. I had 8 clients left. So, and they
did
were
you
all
power it out, or did you go home,
dude? And these are clients who are, and I'm cool with these people. I know them very well, so I could probably tell them, "Hey, I had an edible earlier," but you know, I'm very professional. A lot of these clients are doctors and surgeons and whatever, and I don't want it's unprofessional. I don't want to be like, "Hey, you know, I decided to get high before our session," because you know they're paying me good money and I want to do a good job. So, I just start getting high. And it doesn't slow down. Like, for anyone who's ever experienced this before, you know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. It starts to ramp up and ramp up. And then right when you're like, okay, it's like...
Yeah, okay, now we're settled.
Yeah.
No.
It goes up. There's more. There's more coming.
There's more party.
There's more that's happening. And it keeps getting higher and higher and higher. And of course, my clients decide to have the most complicated questions of all time.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, and I'm sitting there trying to answer... And so I end up just giving in. I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to have a funny training sessions day today.
Yeah.
And I just start joking around.
Divert
with
them.
Like, yeah. Oh, yeah. And yeah. I'm having fun. I'm laughing. I'm, you know,
yeah,
I'm like.
Totally.
And one of my clients is like, are you, you know, here's the worst part. If you're in this situation, you're already paranoid. So if somebody says something.
But you want to be like normal.
Yes.
Yeah.
If somebody says something in a joking way. You're like, you don't get it as joking. You think
yeah.
like.
Oh, yeah. You take it super personally.
Yeah. So like, one of my clients was laughing so hard because I was joking.
Started
and she's
to think
like,
she's laughing at you.
And she goes, yeah. And she goes, what did you take earlier? You're so funny. And I'm like, she knows.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God. What a terrible.
Dude, that reminds me. Remember it was like the police officer and his wife or somebody. Like, He took contraband and brought it back to the house and like some of the like pot brownies or something and then called like they're dying.
Called 911.
Oh my God.
All time's moving.
Talk about slow
right now.
That's so funny. I bet you like never heard the end of that. Yeah.
Hey, so I have a total off topic here.
Yes.
It's I just remember that I've had quite a few people ask this about Thrive Market. Doug, do you know that or maybe Justin, because I know you've already ordered from them, is people are asking if they had already ordered from Thrive Market. Now, if they order again, can they use the Mind Pump code? And then how does that work? Because the Mind Pump code really just gives them the $60 kickback plus the first month free, plus they get $60 towards their shopping.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think the first time you get the free 1 month membership, you get $60. And I believe that's spread over your first three orders.
Oh, it's spread out over three orders.
So it's $20 per order that you get discounted if I... recall correctly.
Okay. No, I think that's it. I think that's it because the prices are so low. I don't think there's like this discount on top of
it. Yeah, I don't think it's a reoccurring thing.
I think it's a discount off the
membership.
The actual
market itself, you're getting a great discount by
because it's only
buying the product.
It's only $60 a year, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's $60 a year, and then you get $60 towards shopping. So when you use the Mind Pump code, you're going to get $60 towards your, and you have your first month free, plus you get $60 towards your
spend. Yeah.
But it's over three. You're telling me it's over three.
Three orders.
So you get 20.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But once you've used that, you've used that.
That's yes. It's a hell of a deal.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a great deal.
Yeah, yeah. So actually, I ordered a bunch of products from them. And then
what'd you order?
So I ordered coconut oil and avocado oil and some like skincare products. But then I also ordered, my poor kids, right? I'm always trying to feed them like super ultra healthy. And I ordered these vegetable-based pizza crusts. I don't want to shout out the name of the company because my kids didn't like it. I loved it. I thought it was fucking amazing. Love the taste of it. So I'm like, hey, kids, we're going to have pizza tonight. They're like, yay. Now, I forget that I'm speaking to, pizza snobs, which is they're Italian kids. Italians are pizza snobs. Mm. And they're used to homemade.
Because you get like made from scratch.
They're used to like pizza crust, like made from, crust, right?
Right.
So I make these like vegetable ones, which are like cauliflower and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I make the pizza. And right away, my daughter, she lifts the corner of it up and she looks at the crust and she goes, what's wrong with it?
Oh, man.
I'm like, it's really good. She goes, are you trying to make us eat healthy again? I said, no.
She said that to
yeah,
you?
Yeah, she does. I said, yeah, it's healthy, but it's really good. You got to try it. She's like, but it's not pizza. I said, it's like pizza. I said, try it. Just take a bite. So this little shit, she takes a fucking speck of a piece, like a little speck, and eats it. I don't like it.
Oh,
I'm like, you have to eat a whole piece before. Yeah, you have to eat a whole piece before you decide if you like it or not. She's like, no, I already know I don't like it.
Yeah,
and so I'm like,
my youngest does that stuff.
Yeah, so I'm like,
God, that would frustrate the shit out of me.
Bro, I'm like,
how do you know? I'd be just like, well, this is what we're eating tonight.
Yeah, that's kind of how it goes sometimes.
You don't have to eat it if you don't want to. Yeah. Well, I'm hungry.
You go to bed hungry.
Well, so
let me know if you want me to save you a piece.
When you're dealing with my kids, what you're dealing with are, remember, they've got my genes in them, so I can play that game with them, and they're gonna fucking throw it right back. So I'll say to her like, well, that's all you're going to have. And she's like, well, I'm not going to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, well, that's fine.
Yeah.
You'll eat that for breakfast tomorrow too.
Yeah.
And she goes, well, then I won't eat breakfast. And I'm like, you're not going to eat.
Sounds a lot like my youngest.
And I'm like, you're not going to eat until you have a whole slice of pizza. You're not going to eat any food.
Yeah.
And she's like, well, I go to mom's house in 2 days, so I'll just eat over there.
Oh, man.
I'm just going to two-day fast.
And it's just, it goes this back and forth.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, this is going to be, like, what do I do now?
That's funny. I've noticed because, like, I got the uncured bacon bars from Epic.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I love those.
Yeah. So they've
uncured bacon bars. What are those?
Oh, they're super
fucking
good,
they're like protein
it's like
bars.
Meat bars.
But they're meat.
It's like meat instead of all the, you know, like whey protein with all the shit in it.
It's a meat bar, bro.
Yeah, it's a meat bar, dude. It's brilliant.
It's like you took.
Anyway,
does Thrive sell those?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow,
yeah, I got them off there.
Fucking love meat bars.
So the only problem is, dude, like, I went to go grab one because I've been randomly eating them throughout the day or whenever, like, I felt like I was hungry. And, dude, half of them are gone. My boys have been eating them and, like, they're just taking all of my bacon bars. I'm getting pissed.
Oh.
Yeah.
They make bacon bars.
Oh, it's the best, dude. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That's one of the finds on there I was, like, pumped on. I was like, oh, these are good. Mm. Yeah.
So, oh, sorry, Doug.
Yeah, no, I found out exactly how this goes down.
Oh, thank God. Save us.
All right. So everybody who signs up will get $20 off their first three purchases for $49 or more.
Okay.
And that also includes free shipping. And they also get a 30-day free trial on the whole thing. So basically, hardly costs anything to get a bunch of free groceries, including those bars.
So what I'm wondering then is maybe the question people are asking me is, what if they already signed up and have a membership with Thrive? Can they come back and use Mind Pump? I think maybe that's the problem.
You can flip them. We'll do like old school 24. Cancel your membership, re-enroll.
I don't think that's how it works.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think
how
it's
that
a one time deal.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, I think so. Like if you're already going.
I mean, everybody's trying to game the system all the time, right?
So since we're on the topic, I did order because I drink. I have a sleep routine that I do every night where I'll make myself like chamomile tea sometimes or valerian root if I really want to sleep hard. So I did.
I thought you were using the mushroom one from Four Sigmatic.
I am. Oh. So what I did was I drank valerian root tea, which you shouldn't drink valerian root every night because it is a pretty remarkable sedative. Like if you drink valerian root and you try and stay awake, you're going to feel a little loopy.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
That sounds like fun.
So I had, of course you said that. So I had, I drank the valerian root tea and I drank it with the reishi and I fucking slept hard. You ever go to sleep where you go to sleep in one position, like you lay down
And you stay right there.
And I woke up in that exact same.
That's a good sleep.
Yeah. I slept really, really hard.
Technically, it's probably not, but it fucking feels. Isn't it, when you're that tired and you sleep like that,
Hard. But I like reishi, the reishi mushrooms from Four Sigmatic, because I use them for that. Or if I have a lot of caffeine, I'll drink it with the caffeine and it takes off the edge. So I get this nice, smooth kind of energy.
Dude, every time you say valerian, I feel like that's like a race of people, you know, and like
the Valerians.
The Valerians.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, like in Lord of the Rings.
Did you have the tincture?
Yeah.
Just now?
No, I did not.
Oh, okay.
It's all natural. That was an original thought.
Dude, it's crazy when you think about it. One spray is too high of a dose.
Yeah. No.
One spray, what did we figure out, was 17 milligrams?
Yeah. You're just like, ksh, ksh, ksh. Yeah.
I scored. It was 4 or 5. I don't remember.
I'm so happy.
Yeah. I know. I closed my mouth immediately. I'm like, no.
I'm so happy I didn't have any with you because you came over to me and you're like, Sal,
I
have one.
I was, you know what's crazy?
I'm like, nah, I'm cool.
Had either one of you opened your mouth, I would have squirted at least 2 in there.
Oh, my God.
So we would have been on a fucking ride.
You destroyed me.
It would have been a ride, dude. Everybody would have been,
I would have hated it because I would have thought I was dying.
Imagine Doug, how pissed Doug would be. We would have been just all over the place.
If you gave it to him?
Yeah, no, we're just all over the place.
I would have just like been in the corner. Just.
Doug wouldn't be mad. He's used to it.
Yeah.
Oh, here you go again.
Here.
No, I'm glad I didn't do it because I tend to get paranoid more than you because you're like, oh, fuck, I'm just going to go to bed. I'd be like, I'm dying.
Yeah.
Call an ambulance.
I was, you know, it took Katrina quite, she must have asked me like 5 times because she thought I was just fucking around. And then she's just like, you're just really high. You're fine. I'm like, no, I'm like really bad. Like we were sitting down. Remember,
I'm like in the stratosphere.
She's been working on all these. She's got Cassie working on these reports for me and stuff. Right. So just analytics for the business and shit. And that's one of my things that I like to do with her. Like this is. We sit down at nighttime and we kind of relax.
So romantic.
Right.
Yeah. It's, let's go over
a little peering into Adam's life a little bit. Yeah. We sit down and go over graphs and
over a nice Chianti.
So we'll sit down and, you know, and she knows that I like to do that, right? It's my thing that I like to do. It's for her, not so much, right? But she's showing me these reports that I've been asking for some time and I'm excited to look at them. And she's looking at me and she goes, I must have been staring at the screen for a long time with not saying anything. And she's like, oh my God. She goes, you are really high. And I'm like, what? I'm just looking at, you know,
you try and act cool, right?
You try and act like you're fine, right?
I'm way.
No, I'm just looking at it. She goes, oh yeah. She goes, what are you looking at? She's just like, the reports I asked for. And she's like, well, do you know what you're looking at? And I'm like, yeah, I know what I'm looking at. And then
GPS report.
She starts quizzing me, like asking me questions. And I'm like, why are you fucking with me? You
know, it's the cover letter. You're just staring at the cover letter.
Then she finally looks at it. She goes, do you want to look at these later? And I'm like, yeah, we should probably look at them later. And that was right before we went for our walk. So it was... That was pretty bad.
Bring the stoner bird, please.
Yeah, bring out the stoner bird. Yeah.
This quaz is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
All right, our first question is from Brittany Flores. How does one know if they have a damaged metabolism?
That's a good question.
It is a good question because I think
we get a lot of questions on this along these lines.
Well, we get metabolic damage has become it's another one of those words, right?
Buzz terms.
Yeah, it's become another buzz term.
Oh, by the way, I'm pretty sure they're going to start selling supplements to fix this pretty soon.
Oh, yeah.
I guarantee it.
Oh, yeah.
Damaged metabolism, take this pill.
Absolutely. I think that's a great call. That's a great prediction on that one, too, is for sure we will see people market to this. And again, this is what sucks. Yes, it's real. Yes, we've dealt with it. Is it as common as it's starting to become? No, I don't believe it's that common. I believe that most people... have just a poor relationship with food, don't understand how much they're actually moving throughout the
Most
day.
Most people just eat poorly and are lazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
I hate to say it.
No, it is. No, it's true.
You know what it reminds me of? Like 20 years ago when I was first became a personal trainer, the excuse was, I think I have low thyroid. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
I think my thyroid's low. And
right.
I'd be like, well, go get a blood test and come back. No, it's not.
Right.
Well, genetics then.
You just don't. Yeah, exactly.
So when I would see it, right?
Big boned.
Is when I would have, and this is, again, why the tracking and all that shit, why I'm so I could eliminate this as a possibility.
Because when it is an issue.
It's obvious to me.
Well, yes, and not only
you really
that.
You have to work for it.
Only that, but there's a specific protocol.
Well, yeah, right. So you have, and when I see it's most common, it looks like this. I get somebody who has some sort of a very active like day where they are just, they move a lot, like 20,000 steps. Like that's a lot of moving. You have an active job or you're moving a lot, right? And then you're only eating, you know, 1,200 calories or so a day and you're 50 pounds overweight. Like when you're overweight, you're moving that much and you're eating that little consistently. And I've had you track and we've been looking at this and you're not, the scale is not moving. Yeah, this person probably has some metabolic damage. So
I think we should also, let's be very clear, because the term damaged metabolism metabolic
adrenal
damage.
Adrenal fatigue is the.
Right, or adrenal fatigue or HPA axis dysfunction, whatever. It's technically, your metabolism is not damaged. It's doing exactly what it's supposed to.
Ooh, great point.
So it's not like you're broken. It's just your body has now adapted to a lot of stress, whether it be exercise or lack of sleep or too many stimulants or poor stress management, you know, life, whatever. And it's adapted to just the high level of activity. And it's also adapted to low calorie intake. So in reality, your metabolism is not damaged. It's doing what it's supposed to, which is adapt to, you know, the stimulus that you throw at it. So in this particular case, your metabolism is efficient. It's burning less calories. Your receptors for hormones like cortisol may be downregulated. Your hormones have been altered and changed, basically to keep you functioning and alive. Remember, your body's number one goal is to keep you alive. It doesn't. That's the secondary goal would be to keep you long term healthy and keep you, you know, feeling good and all that stuff. But number one, you got to be alive. In extreme cases where they've had prisoners of war, where they'll take these people who've been, you know, captured and held prisoner for years. And fed very, very little and forced to work ridiculous, hours and whatever and under high stresses, they'll find people that these people are surviving. And of course, they look horrible and they feel horrible, but they're surviving on incredibly low calories. Their bodies have adapted to this extreme stress. So to a much less extent, you're in a situation where maybe you approached your weight loss with the following methods. You know, I need to lose, 70 pounds, so I'm going to do tons of cardio. That's typically what happens. Tons and tons of cardio.
And reduce your calories.
I'm going to cut my calories. I'm going to count everything. And then you lose like 50 pounds or whatever. And now you're stuck with the last 10 or 15 or 20. And
well, don't you feel like this is where most people
can't
like.
Can't you simplify it a lot by just like realizing how low of calories like you've deduced yourself down to?
And so I feel
the biggest
like,
loser, they're all in this category.
Yeah, I feel like for the most part, a majority of our society under consume like nutrients that their body needs, right? We over consume calories. We fucking overload on sugar and stuff that we don't need, but we really under consume on the nutrient dense foods and the things that our body needs. So we already for the most part, the average American already is setting themselves up for not a less optimal running systems, right? Because you're not fueling it properly and you're oversaturating and you're overfilling it with garbage. And then you decide you're going to get in shape. And so what you do is you grossly reduce all of that stuff that you were consuming before that you knew wasn't good for you, and you cut it in half or you eliminate it completely. So your calories now are 1,000 to 1,500 calories a day. And then you introduce all of this, all this cardio and stuff inside of your day. So you have this drastic swing of, I already wasn't fueling my body what it needs to work optimally, and I'd already got it adapted to that. Now I'm going to reduce that even more, and I'm going to put more stress on it by pushing it on cardio. And it's normally a very short-lived results. They get a results for a week or two. They lose a couple pounds towards their 50-pound plus goal. And then they do that for a while, get frustrated and say, fuck this. I was happier eating Taco Bell and, you know, not exercising and a couple pounds heavier.
Who's ever said I've been happier eating Taco Bell?
Yeah. Lots of people.
Wow. Yeah.
Lots of people.
Well, that hurts my asshole thinking about that.
It's a tough situation to be in. You know, here you are. You lost, you know, 50 pounds or whatever. You're consuming 1,200 calories a day. You're doing, you know, 30 minutes to an hour of cardio every single day. You've already got a busy life. You've already got a job. Maybe you have kids. What do you do now? Like, in order to keep that weight off, you got to keep doing exactly what you've been doing, which means for the rest of your life, you got to do that. And you go on a vacation, which is, I've seen this many, many times. People will go on vacation for a week, enjoy themselves a little bit, poof, gain 10 pounds.
Yeah.
And they're like, what the fuck? Like, no matter, like, the slightest thing that I do,
it tips the scale massively.
I gain weight so fast. Yeah. If you're in this category, you'll have weight fluctuations that seem pretty dramatic. You know you're here because you've got yourself here through doing the things that we just talked about.
Yeah.
And your body your metabolism just is kind of slow.
Yeah.
The remedy for this, the ultimate remedy for this, there's a lot of things you have to do, but the one main remedy is to build muscle and get stronger.
Mm-hmm.
That's really the only signal that tells your body that it's okay to be less efficient with calories, because you're sending a signal through lifting weights that you need this muscle more than anything. So now your body's going to speed up its metabolism.
We are about to release a guide that Sal revised, the nutrition guide, that I think is incredible for someone like this. Like, talk about and it's, in my opinion, the blueprints on how to help and fix somebody with a damaged metabolism. Everything from first working on your relationship with your own body and learning to separate body and self-image, and then your relationship with food, and then how to implement exercise. I mean, it literally walks you through step by step what that looks like, and then it gives you all types of different options of different diets that we talk about on the show. And I think that the mistake that most people make in this situation is they fall in that yo-yoing mm-hmm. of totally on, totally off. And if you think you have a damaged metabolism, which, like we said earlier, very few people actually truly have that, normally you're caught in this yo-yoing of off and on the wagon because you just swing from one extreme to the other.
This is more common amongst people who compete a lot. That's where I see it the most.
Right.
Yeah, when people come to me and they're like, oh my God, I have so much trouble like getting leaner. And then I ask them their history, and they're like, oh, I competed in three shows or two shows recently. Then I say, okay, you know, let's look and see if we're dealing with a quote-unquote, you know, damaged metabolism. If I have an average person, and what I mean by average is someone who didn't compete, and they come to me and they say, Sal, look, like I work out and I eat right and whatever, and I just can't lose weight. And I ask them their history, and their history includes marathons or, you know, I don't get good sleep. I work really, you know, lots of hours. I got three kids. I do tons of, you know, exercise. I'm drinking, you know, six cups of coffee a day. Then I'll also think there may be some damaged metabolism. If they come to me and say, I can't lose weight, whatever, and I go, well, what's your history? And it's, you know, I'm inactive and I just, you know, eat a bad diet. Probably not a damaged metabolism. You know, lift weights, get stronger, eat adequate fat. You don't want to go keto. You still want to have some carbs, but you're not going to have a carb-heavy diet. Reduce your cardio slowly. Don't drop it cold turkey because you'll rebound very quickly. Get better sleep and learn how to manage your stress and give it some time. Unfortunately, getting out of this situation is going to take some months, not weeks. It's going to take some months before your body's hormones and everything starts to balance out and before you start to notice some of the positive effects of the work that you're doing. So
I also highly recommend to anybody who may think they're suffering with this or wants more information in this direction is to go to the coaching that we have online, which is totally free. You go to mindpumpmedia.com and you can sign up for free 30 days of coaching. And we literally have broken up every single day with a topic. And it's the same way that one of us would talk to somebody who's hired us that's wanting to learn about themselves, their body, different macro, micronutrients, exercise, everything. Every day we address something different. We make it very user-friendly with links to direct you straight to videos and podcast episodes where we talk specifically about that topic. So if it's something you feel very familiar with, you can move on to the next day. If it's something that you want to know more, you could spend hours diving deeper into that that topic. So go to the 30 days of coaching at mindpumpmedia.com.
Quick commercial break. Hey, people ask us all the time how they can support Mind Pump. Here's what you can do. You can go to www.brain.fm/mindpump and get 20% off Brain FM for meditation or focus. You can also go to audibletrial.com/mindpump and get a 30-day trial plus one free audio book. Lastly, you can go to getnatureblend.com/mindpump and you will get a discount on Ben Greenfield's CBD product.
Next up is SRHYSE. Your opinions on DHT blockers like finasteride.
You know what? I blame this shit on you fuckers.
What?
Ever since you guys started making fun of me about going bald, you know how many you know how many fucking DMs I get because of you guys?
No, you don't.
Oh, I get a DM. I get a DM almost every day from somebody who wants to help me out.
Oh man,
with your hair? Help me. Yeah, I want to help.
Dude, our pump heads are so helpful.
Oh, they're hilarious. They're all hilarious too. They set them up like, hey, they're all very sensitive.
Hey, man,
because like, we've also built me up to be such an asshole, right, so they like tiptoe into like presenting me their fucking their hair product. Right? They're just like
bro, you gotta try. I'm not saying you got an issue.
Yeah, but, yeah. Right, right. Yeah, I'm not. Yeah. I'm not trying to be offensive. Yeah. And I think
you look great.
You look great.
Everything's great.
I have heard you talk about.
So
thank you all for all the fucking advice you want to give me.
Well, because this question was from somebody who is asking for hair loss.
Right.
So DHT blockers, finasteride, dutasteride, these are chemicals, prescription drugs that you can take that reduce or eliminate the conversion of testosterone to dehydrotestosterone.
Isn't that what's in most all these Boswell and fucking all these hair club for men type fucking shampoos? They don't all possess this?
No. You have to have a prescription to have dutasteride or finasteride. The shampoos may have something different, but no, these are prescription.
Oh, okay.
Now,
I was unaware of that.
Here's the thing with...
Man, that's why I'm bald.
Here's the thing with DHT. DHT is, like all hormones in the body, has essential functions. Hair loss is not unless you have like a nutrient deficiency, where you're lacking something in your diet and you're sick or whatever. If you're healthy and you're losing your hair, then you're losing your fucking hair. Like, stop trying to prevent a normal thing that's happening to your body.
Thank God, I feel like someone's finally defending me.
Because here's the problem. DHT has got all these effects in the body that are very important.
Right.
For example... it increases strength through the central nervous system. It's more potent than testosterone when it comes to affecting the central nervous system. It very, very strong effects on sense of well-being, confidence, and libido. So one of the major side effects of taking anything that reduces or blocks
boner killer.
Big libido.
This is my theory, and correct me if you think I'm wrong here, but first of all, it runs in my family, so I believe I already have the genes. Mm-hmm. I fucked around with steroids in my early 20s a lot. And so I'm sure that accelerated or expressed those genes that I already had. And then I tried, and then it was just a little bit, right? So when I saw it coming on in my mid to late 20s, I for sure blamed it on, well, that's what I get for fucking around with testosterone in my early 20s. And now here's this gene that's in my family that I expressed it for fucking around with my hormones. And all these products, and let me tell you, I've tried a lot of them. I haven't tried a prescription version though, so I didn't know that. But most of them, what would happen is I would feel like it made a little bit of a difference while I was taking it. Like it was like you get this like little peach fuzz that starts to grow a little bit. So like it kind of to the average eye, like it looks like it kind of fills it in a little bit more. Mm. But then the moment I stopped taking it, I would lose more hair. So these products I feel like my body gets adapted to taking them.
On them forever.
Yeah, then my hair needs it to leave and to keep the little peach fuzz going on, and then I end up losing more from it. So I finally just accepted this shit and just said, you know what, I like wearing fucking hats anyways.
Yeah.
It's gonna go. It's going. You know what I'm saying? It's like
kind of like the hair in a can thing.
The more that I fuck with it, the worse it is. So it's just one of those things that I don't. You know, we joke about it, but I really don't care that
well,
much.
Well, here's what's happening. So when you have male pattern baldness or androgenic alopecia is the technical term, and women, by the way, can suffer from this as well. It's just far more rare because they don't have nearly the levels of DHT that men will have. What happens is it's not that you have high levels of DHT in your system, you know, more than others. It's that you have probably a high density of DHT receptors in your scalp, whereas some men can take all the steroids in the world and won't lose a single hair. And it's because they don't have a lot of DHT receptors in their scalp. Other men have more DHT receptors in their prostate. And so they'll suffer from, and that's me.
Enlarged prostate.
That's me, yours truly. Now, I'm not suffering from it yet, but I'm pretty sure I'm going to deal with these issues as I get older.
That finger check.
Because it's on all sides of my family. Like all the men in my family have dealt with some kind of prostate enlargement. And that's also because you have a high propensity of receptors for DHT in the prostate. So the two methods that you can use to prevent this natural hair loss would be either stop or reduce the conversion of testosterone to dihydrotestosterone, which is not a good idea because, again, remember, this is a hormone that's naturally occurring in the body that has all these other functions. Or you could try to block the DHT receptors in these areas. So one thing you can do, and I've told you about this, Adam, is you can try saw palmetto shampoo. Saw palmetto shampoo there is some evidence that when you leave it on your scalp, it will attach to the DHT receptors in the scalp, block them so that the DHT that you naturally have flowing in your body won't attach to these receptors and then you won't lose as much hair. The reason why you probably notice...
Now, is that the idea of that is to slow down the process? It's not going to actually regrow the hair?
You may get some regrowth, but it's highly unlikely. Mostly what will happen, and really in the studies that I've read, is that it works well for men who lose hair on the crown of their head, not in the front, not in the forehead. For some reason, that kind of hair loss is like... That goes away, and it's like the hardest thing to stop. It's the crown of the head. And this is true for minoxidil and those other drugs too that regrow hair. It's like it works in the back of the head but not in the front for whatever reason. But when you use these, they'll stop or slow down hair loss. When you stop using them, what happens is your body catches up to where it was going to normally be. That's why you may notice more or faster hair loss. Not because you're necessarily getting a rebound effect, although now that I'm talking about it, it is a totally viable theory that blocking receptors may cause the upregulation of receptors because your body's always trying to balance itself out. So that's interesting. I would like to see that, but
that's just my own personal theory. Yeah. I'm not trying to say that's for a fact or not, but it just got to the point where it's like, none of this shit's going to make that big of a difference. Like, I'm not really tripping on it very
much. No, DHT is an important... I'll tell you what.
But I'm sure there's a lot of people out there that are interested.
I'll tell you what. Anabolic steroids. Okay,
let's go with the Bruce Willis.
Let's talk about anabolic steroids. Anabolic steroids are typically derivatives of testosterone, but there are some anabolic steroids that are derivatives of dehydrotestosterone, DHT. Bodybuilders don't typically use these steroids alone because they don't give you big mass gains.
You mean like Masteron?
Yes, but they make your muscles hard and they give you lots of strength gains. Winstrol is one of them. Primobolan is one of them. Anavar is one of them. And Masteron is one of them. Masteron in particular is known for giving you this hard look and making you real strong. But if you have any kind of propensity for hair loss and you take Masteron, that shit's gonna happen.
And they're all things I've fucked with.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I've taken Masteron, I've taken Anavar, and I've taken, what else did you say?
Winstrol.
I've taken all those.
Yeah. And Masteron's probably the worst one. I think that one's got the worst.
And I actually remember the first time that I took that, and I remember my hair not long afterwards. And that was actually when
just
I started
coming out.
Yeah. I was like, oh, wow. This is the first time I'd ever seen me actually wash my hair and see the hair in my hands.
Now, sometimes people are prescribed finasteride or dutasteride for benign hyperplasia of the prostate, prostate enlargement, and it helps with that. Again, there's things you could do dietarily, and herbs and stuff you can take. I'll tell you what, reishi. We just talked about reishi, the mushroom reishi, which I get from Four Sigmatic. That has a here's why I like adaptogen so much. This is why I fucking love adaptogen type compounds like reishi. When you take them, if you have an imbalance, it balances you out. It doesn't fucking throw you off whack in one way or the other. You know what I'm saying? So reishi is one of those things that has been shown to balance out DHT. So if you're overproducing it, or you've got some kind of, you know, if you're out of balance, it'll help bring it down and make it feel better. If you're underproducing it, it'll help bring it back up to normal level. So there's things you could do naturally that may help. None of them are going to be as strong as the pharmaceuticals in terms of, you know, preventing hair loss. But I'll tell you what, I've had several clients, male clients, who took finasteride or dutasteride, stopped taking it because they had like erectile dysfunction from it. And then when they stopped taking it took months.
That. Yeah.
It took months to get it back.
I just started to get all weary about putting all these different chemicals in my head.
What are the long-term effects?
Right. Just to try and save or slow down the process of my hair loss. And so I don't even know the name. I know someone's going to ask me of what Katrina has me on right now, but it's just like an organic shampoo that doesn't have any fucking chemicals inside of it. And it's like that to me.
You know,
I wash it like every other day instead of every day.
You know what raises DHT?
What?
There's one study that shows that creatine raises DHT a little bit, and even testosterone a little bit. So good and bad, I guess. You know, guys trying to raise their testosterone levels probably take a little creatine among other things.
Next question is from M. Bastia. Thoughts on steroids? Any advice for someone who found out their significant other has taken them and will probably take them again?
Speaking of steroids,
we're just talking about that.
Segue right into that one.
This is an interesting question. I almost feel like it's a relationship question more than anything.
It is more of a relationship question than it is a steroid question when you think about it.
Yeah, because like I feel like
it's sneaky.
Yeah, like I just found out as if they didn't tell you before, which is kind of a red flag.
Yeah, it's kind of a relationship communication thing.
Yeah, kind of a red flag, and they're going to take them again. You know, that's something you got to talk about with each other, because I know plenty of people who take anabolic steroids and their spouses and significant others know and everybody's cool with it. But if that's your red line, because you may have that, you may think that to yourself, like, I don't want them to take it because they're breaking the law, whatever your reason.
Well, in the defense of the person who's not sharing it, because I think right away you think, I'm going back in my head thinking about, did I share that with every girlfriend? And I don't think I did. I think if I had a girlfriend that I was dating and we're, you know, who knows how long, how many months we are into a relationship.
You're serious. Yeah.
Right. And I was taking steroids. Would I share it with that person? I don't know. Like, I don't think I did with everyone. And mostly because if I didn't think they knew enough about it or understood it, that they would just freak out and judge over it. And it's like, I didn't want to have that conversation. And it was more like, I'm just going to avoid
that. But you're a kid.
Yeah, I'm in my 20s, right? So yeah. I was, you know, I'm a grown ass man. I had my own place. I had a girl living with me, and I was technically hiding that from them for that reason. So I can relate to keeping it away from my partner for this exact reason, because if she were to get freaked out to where it's like, oh my God, my partner's been taking steroids, what do I do? Like, well, I mean, you don't really do anything. It's not your body. It's up to you. And if you're not okay with being with someone that takes them or is at all using them, then I guess it's something that you have the option to be out of that relationship. But for someone like me, that wouldn't obviously be a game changer or a deal breaker for me.
Well, I think a thing that we should talk about then in this is it a problem? Like, if your boyfriend and or girlfriend is taking, well, let's talk about guys for a second, because talking about girls is a whole different topic.
Which I actually thought this was a guy asking the question.
Here's the thing. If a woman is taking steroids, she's hormonally making herself turn into a man. So
it's so bad to say this, but I feel like I'd have a different, if it's a girl.
Well, no, it's the effects of testosterone on men are more subtle than the effects of testosterone on a woman. It's like giving estrogen to a man. Like you're from a hormonal level, you are telling her body to become more
changing
male.
Changing the whole chemistry.
You are. Now, that being said, when a guy is taking testosterone or steroids, if he's taking the gym doses, which are not replacement doses, they're taking probably, you know, 200 to 500 milligrams of testosterone a week.
At the minimum.
Or more. Are there behavioral effects on that person? The answer, yes, of course there is. Now, are there studies to show that there's behavioral effects from taking, you know, 500 milligrams of testosterone a week long term? No, because I think getting a study like that, I don't think you'd get approved to do a study like that, because the doses of testosterone that these guys are using, even at 500 milligrams, which is still considered an average dose among gym goers, is still extremely high compared to your normal testosterone levels. And I don't know if you'd get approval, you know, to get to study that type of a dose. I don't know if they'd even let you administer that much to somebody long term. But you get people on the other side who take steroids are like, no, it doesn't affect your behavior. I'm exactly the same. That's not true, because testosterone does have behavioral effects. It is a hormone that does change how your brain develops. It does change the structure of your brain while you're on it. It does, you know, it definitely affects things like libido and energy. So it is going to affect other things. And when you are taking that much testosterone, it does throw off other hormones like estrogen and other hormones that react to high levels of testosterone. Can you expect that this person may have potential mood swings more than they normally would? Will they have, are they more likely to do certain things, risky behavior? These are all things that I would say probably yes. I know that there was one survey study that was done on men who took anabolic steroids, and they found that there were much higher rates of, and these are married men, higher rates of things like infidelity. Now, the problem with a study like that is it the steroids that's causing it, or is it the maybe low insecurity, the reason why they're taking it causing that? So it's hard to weed this stuff out, but for
so many variables that come into play here. Yeah. It's, I mean, here's the thing, like let's pretend it's not steroids. Let's pretend it's any drug, like anything. And you can, and anybody who is abusing anything, I think, is a red flag, and I think is something that you should probably be concerned about in a relationship. So it doesn't, I think the fact that it's steroids is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that steroids, let's replace it with cocaine, or let's replace it with painkillers, or let's replace it with even food addiction. Like, if you've got somebody who can't go without or needs something, and you can, and they, then they live their life that. Now, if you are dating somebody who competes and has aspirations to be a pro bodybuilder one day, and he cycles on and off occasionally, and that's what he's into and really wants to, well, you kind of signed up for that when you probably got together with that guy or girl.
And the reality is, if you're dating a hardcore competitor and you're not in that world, probably the least difficult thing you have to deal with is your steroid use, just to be honest. You know, you're dealing with, I mean, competing is a very selfish sport just by nature. All the food you got to carry and all the workouts and all that stuff. But, you know, the flip is true too. You know, I've talked to people about this, and you'll hear, I've heard women like, oh my God, you know, I'm afraid his behavior will change this and that. It's like, well, you take birth control. Like, female hormones change behavior in women too. And they're subtle. The changes are subtle, but it does change. It's
just as fair of an argument.
It is. And it's
just as fair of an argument, for sure.
I don't like it when people are like, no, there's no side effects. There's no changes in behavior if someone takes, you know, 15 times or 100 times a dose of testosterone in their body. Well, that's bullshit. Of course it's going to have something. It could be very subtle.
Right.
But it's going to have some
And I think we've talked about it before. If you're an asshole, it tends to exaggerate that. You know, if you're already somebody who is a prick and has a temper, and then you take something like that, it tends to exaggerate.
In my experience,
it seems like less empathy is involved.
Yeah. Yep.
Sometimes.
And in my experience, when I've had friends, like I said, very close friends who've done hardcore cycles, when I see the biggest change in their behavior is when they're cycling off.
Oh yeah, when they come off, they're
when they come out, because it's so unbalanced that not good.
Yeah,
that's when I see the bad shit.
That's when you know. Yeah, that's when you really see what it was ramping up to, and they're like off, and it's like this hot mess and crying and all these like crazy feelings.
They can get emotional or just like really fucking pissed off, become assholes.
Yeah,
you know, because they don't feel good. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
What I've noticed when my buddies will take high doses, when they're taking the high doses, all I notice is that just their what I would see typically, not all of them, because some of them you can't even tell, but some of you just get this inflated ego, right? Like, oh my God, I feel fucking great. I can lift. I can do all these different things. I'm so horny. I'm so fucking, you know, masculine and all this shit. And, but I mean, if they're hiding it from you, I think the problem isn't necessarily steroids. It's the fact that maybe you don't have the communication.
Well, and I think that because I feel like right now, and I'm trying to defend he or her. I don't know if it's I can't, this person's profile is private, so I don't know if I'm talking to a female or male. But I feel the need to defend the other person because I think with communication and in my relationships in the past. So like. Katrina and I have a total different relation. It's full disclosure. She knew from day one everything I always, you know.
Which is the best.
Right. And I think that it took me years until I was in my 30s that I realized, like, that's the relationship I want. I want a relationship that I can share anything and everything that I do and not be judged by my partner, be able to communicate it, and then her openly be able to say, I have a problem with it, and say she doesn't like it. And, you know, and I've told her that before, and, you know, if I wouldn't want her to, like, I'd want her to not be okay if she saw me abusing something or letting it take control of my life, and I would like that open communication. So I think as a partner, you have to be careful too on how you come at this conversation, because if you hammer this your partner for not sharing this, maybe they didn't share it for a reason, because you may be the type of person that's inflammatory when you share something that maybe you don't agree or know a lot
or
about.
Or you haven't really shared anything about you that, you know, who knows?
What someone like this, like, you know, I don't know the person who's taking it. Hopefully they have done a little bit of their own homework and research on what it is they're doing and for whatever reasons they're doing it for. That maybe you don't have, you have not done that much research. You don't know that much about it. And then you're just assuming that, oh my God, it's so scary. It's so bad. It's so dangerous, these things. And then your conversation, you deliver that message that way. And so of course the partner is going to be in defense or not want to share certain things with you. It's like anything else. You know, I think it's the same thing when you get relationships where the partner cheats all the time because the other partner is so, like, is like a hover, is hovering over you all the time and in your business. That always drives the partner into cheating on you. It's so crazy. Anyone that's been in enough relationships, when you have all the freedom in the world, it's less desirable to go run off and cheat somebody. But if you got a partner who's calling you every 5 minutes, wanting, where are you at? What are you doing? What are you doing? It's always that relationship where they end up cheating.
Not gonna last.
The first thing that comes to mind for me when someone's that, like, checking on you, call, you know, what are you doing? It's like, first thought in my mind is like, why are...
Why would I tell them anything?
Well, not only that, but what are you doing?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, people who tend to be super suspicious like that, they're the ones that tend to be the ones.
And I feel like the same thing goes with something like this. It's like everybody, you know, if it's bothering you so much that they didn't share it, like, well, maybe, and again, this is just how I approach it. If I'm this person, I'm always looking at myself. How can I make this... Why didn't this person want to share this with me?
Why didn't they feel comfortable enough?
Right. Why exactly? Like, if Katrina was hiding something like this from me, like, let's just say we've been together for 6.5 years, and all of a sudden I found out she dabbles in cocaine a little bit. Like, she's not like addicted.
Like, whoa.
But, you know, sometimes she has crazy
left field.
Crazy. Yeah. No. But that's how this could feel for this person, right?
Totally.
Right.
No,
and I'm so. One day I find out I just happened to be putting away her panties from laundry, and she's got a little bag of cocaine in there, and I'm like, what the fuck is this? And she's like, oh man, it's just, you know, sometimes work's crazy and I need a little pick me up. And I'm like,
oh my God.
And so we get this.
God, how terrible is that?
It would be, right? It would be. But this could be kind of like how this person feels. Now, how do I react, right? 6.5 years deep, we share everything together. We know everything about each other.
I just need a little.
And she tells me, and what if she told me, okay, how would you handle this? She tells me that, honey, that little baggie you see right there, that's lasted me. I'm so sorry, hun, for using you as an example on cocaine, because my girl doesn't do any of that shit. But let's just say, that's why it would be so mind-blowing, because she doesn't do any of that. If she, she tells me that little baggie she's had for over a year and she hasn't even gone through half of it. So maybe I can count on one hand how many times that she's actually done it and used it. Now, how do I handle that? What am I really mad at? Am I mad because she's done cocaine 5 times?
Or because she hasn't shared.
Or that she hasn't Right. Or that she hasn't shared. But really, I'm not mad at her in this whole situation. I'm wondering, because we have such an open relationship and we talk so much about
everything. Why didn't she talk to me?
Yeah, why wouldn't you just tell me, like, that you needed that?
I had a buddy years ago who was just, this guy was hardcore into dabbling with all the steroids. Terrible genetics, too. You would never know. This guy took shit tons of gear. But anyway, he starts dating this girl, and she knows about all the stuff that he took, and he talks her into letting him inject her with testosterone because he knows testosterone makes people horny. So he's thinking like, oh, dude, you know, so I'm going to give my girl testosterone.
Brilliant plan.
She's going to get horny. We're going to get all freaky. It's going to be so fun.
What?
Yeah.
She gave it to her.
So he gives her testosterone. He fucking gives her, okay? This is true story now. This is way back.
Oh, my God.
Way back when I was, the very first month I was assistant manager at 24 Hour Fitness. He gave her a freaking shot of Sustanon 250. 250 milligrams.
Oh my God.
Of testosterone.
To
a woman, which is a lot of fucking testosterone for a woman. And she fucking loses her mind. Like, it fucks with her head so much, she becomes this emotional mess. And that's long acting. That shit took like weeks to get out of her system, but it was terrible. It was terrible. Oh yeah, it was terrible. Like, what a dumb shit.
Wow.
Yeah.
I would address.
He's like, this will make you horny. I'm like, why don't you just fucking buy her flowers?
Regardless, if it's
why would you do that?
Take her to a rom com. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I would address the communication in the relationship, and I wouldn't be so angry about it as I would be more curious about why we are not at a point in our relationship where we can openly discuss these type of things. Because if it is somebody I love and that I want to spend the rest of my life potentially with, I definitely don't want them to feel like they can't express or share with me and they're going to hide all this shit. So to me, I would address that. Quick commercial break, you guys. We keep getting asked all the time, how can I support the Mind Pump family? Here's one of the best ways you guys can. You guys love that Chimera coffee that we have. Chimera coffee with a K. You go to chimeracoffee.com, put in the discount code MINDPUMP for 10% at the checkout. If you guys have not tried Ben Greenfield's new bars out, they're fantastic. If you want some, go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/naturebite. Put in the code MINDPUMP and get 10% off. Go check it out.
Next up is Nady Lives Happy. What is your stance on cattle being the biggest threat to the climate, forest, and wildlife? As a health and fitness promoter, would you consider a vegetarian lifestyle in the future?
The sky is falling.
You know what?
The sky is falling.
Let me tell you something right now.
Do we need to go here?
This is what we're going to do, because he's right. Cattle do produce a lot of greenhouse gas. She's right. Cattle produce a lot of greenhouse gases. We need to eat them all.
We need to eat them all.
Eat all the cows.
That's what I'm saying.
So this shit will stop.
Hand them to me.
So this is why I love these questions like this. Because you always have to slow down, don't have a knee-jerk reaction, and understand who's giving the message and why the message is given. Is the message that we need to go vegetarian, is it being promoted by actual environmentalists? Or is it being promoted by vegans who don't want us to eat animals? The truth is, it's an argument made by vegans. Environmentalists typically, they talk about changing the ways that we raise our food and do our food and all that stuff, but they don't really have the stance that everybody needs to be vegan. This is a vegan stance, and what vegans do, especially those who are vegans for moral reasons, they use every argument possible to try to convince people to not eat animals. And the latest one is it's better for the environment. And it's only an argument because of the political landscape where you have politicians who are using the environment as a wedge to get people to vote one way or another.
This is also if you still buy into global warming also.
Yeah, well,
because we are global cooling before, now we're global warming. We can't make up our mind. Yeah. The icebergs are melting, but another one's growing. So what the fuck, dude?
Well, I mean,
what the fuck, dude?
As far as the environment is concerned.
Did you know that? I didn't know that until I actually went up there.
Yeah.
When we went up to go to the Glacier Bay, and you know, of course they talk about, you know, global warming, and then they're showing us like the glaciers. This is where they were in 1960, this is where they were at in 1990, and this is where they're at now, right? But nobody ever talks about that. So out of all these glaciers, I can't remember how many were in Glacier Bay Park. There's a ton of them, right? There's actually a significant percentage of them that are actually growing. That the glaciers are actually
like not known information.
Yeah, right, nobody talks about that.
All right, so we're gonna go down this path. So So here's the thing you want to consider with
good
that.
Thing I'm a flat earther.
Here's the thing that you want to go down. You want to consider with that.
This topic always ruffles everybody's feathers.
I know
it's a third rail.
It is a very complicated topic, many, many, many scientists believe that we are, in fact, influencing global climate trends. I'm not a scientist in this. I'm not going to debate them. Here's the real debate. The real debate is because what we also need to understand is that the 20th century saw the largest migration of the world's poor to the world's middle class, the fastest and largest migration that we saw in all of human history. We literally, the United Nations, or, you know, there were organizations whose goals were to reduce poverty by X percent, and we exceeded that like a decade earlier. Part of the reason is because markets became more free worldwide, which we know grows prosperity. And the other part is this is fueled by petroleum-based products. The Industrial Revolution started. If we eliminate oil and petroleum-based products, which, by the way, it's not just oil. It's we use these products in everything. If we eliminate that, you will see a massive, massive, massive death worldwide. If we reduce production of greenhouse gases through legislation, like if we say, hey, if you produce it, you know, you got to pay a tax on all this, or you can't produce this greenhouse gases, wealthy people like us, well, I mean, we'll notice like things are more expensive, stuff, but we're okay. But you go to an emerging market like some people in China or Brazil or Mexico or areas in Africa where these people 2 decades ago were super poor, and now they're coming out, they're considered emerging markets. You implement some of this legislation on them, and you're going to see people dying. You're going to see people starving to death. You're going to see problems.
So why is that?
Because a tax or legislation on us who have all this money, it'll affect us, but not that much. But you throw that on people on these emerging markets, and it becomes a big fucking deal. You add a 10% tax on something to people who have just come out of poverty, and now you're talking about starving these people to death. So what we need to really do is fucking figure this out. Like, fine, we want to eliminate greenhouse gases, but how many people is that going to kill versus how many people it's going to save? And the math in order to calculate this is fucking astounding, and it's super hard to figure out. Like, if you guys watched Al Gore's documentary, In an Inconvenient Truth, the first one or whatever, by now he predicted we'd all be underwater and crazy shit would happen. And this was based on the science. Obviously, it was wrong.
Yeah.
Because it's a very complicated thing to figure out. So as far as the environment is concerned, I think it's definitely a good thing to want a cleaner environment.
Right.
I just don't think it's a fucking smart thing to have this need. And let me tell you something right now. There are special interests on both sides. There are people who are profiting from pushing this agenda that we need to have these crazy, you know, environmental, you know, restrictions on everybody, because they profit from those as well. They also eliminate competition. Nothing, by the way, is going to change or improve the environment faster than an innovation that is cheaper than petroleum. This whole like conspiracy that, you know, there's the answer out there for clean energy, but nobody wants bullshit. That's bullshit. Every company in the world would fucking love an invention that made it cheaper and more efficient for them to produce energy. If somebody discovered that, okay, tomorrow everybody would dump oil. That's a fact.
Well,
that's just the way it is.
The argument to go vegan and to eliminate the cows because of this would be as silly as to, because the cows are number three, is what they claim.
Oh, for environmental pollution?
So you want to know what number one would be? Is us.
Yeah. Well, waste.
Our fucking waste. Yeah, that's coming from us.
Right.
It's our waste, right? Our waste and our gas, our farts, are fucking outdoing the cattle. So at that rate, we should go with China's mentality, which we'd stop. You can only have one child, and we should start to fucking tell people that how many kids they're allowed to have and start killing off the humans.
And it's also, food waste is a bigger producer of pollution for the earth. And vegetable and products are we throw more of that away than we do meat and fish products. So and by the way, growing plants isn't this environmentally friendly, awesome thing. Transporting it, having the land to plant it. We also tend to stick to certain crops because of their ease of how we grow them. They tend to be GMO. Because of that, we spray the fuck out of the earth with these chemicals.
Well, and you now have to kill all the critters that try and eat them.
Really, if we really want to do the right thing with our food supply for the environment, what we'll end up doing is eating insects and eating like algaes. Go. Like we'll grow algaes instead of growing corn, wheat, and all this like rice. Rice is tremendous amount of water to produce rice and all that stuff. We'll eat things like algaes, like spirulina and whatever, and we'll, you know.
I think you're gonna. I think the things which why I'm so excited for us to partner up with a company like Thrive is I think the future of helping stuff like this is more like this. These ability to gather everybody like as a community. It's really like a farmer's market online when you think about it. Mm-hmm. Like that's what they're creating.
Yeah.
And you want to talk about the ideal way for us to be consuming and eating would be that. And that was the hard thing was not everybody has access to a farmer's market, right? Not everybody has that ability where
there's ways we can improve, you know, the industrial farming sort of
big time,
you know, mentality. And like the reality is there's a lot of fucking people out there that you know, we need to produce all this meat towards. And like, I think that it's just gotten out of control to where it's just become this machine that, you know, it definitely needs an eye and it needs, you know, there needs to be sustainable options. There needs to be better ways to, you know, to bring the community involved and get more like in touch with the way that we do all these things. But, mm-hmm. you know, like, so I see that, but like to say to just go stark, you know, vegan, vegetarian, like doesn't make sense.
No,
to me. Not from a health perspective at all.
What this reminds me of is when people do something like, they'll say something like ban guns so we can save children when, you know, swimming pools kill way more kids, but nobody says ban swimming pools, right? That would actually be more rational. Like swimming pools kill way more fucking kids. Ban swimming pools, guarantee we'll save way more children, less children will drown.
Right.
When it comes to food, what's way more important than this, and that makes a bigger impact that we can do right now, is change our own fucking behavior, because nobody wants to change their own. Right, everybody wants to make a law for everybody else. Here's what you do. Mm-hmm. Stop throwing away so much food. That's it.
Yeah.
Do you know how much food developed nations throw in the fucking garbage because we don't eat it, or because we buy all this food and it goes bad in the refrigerator because we're idiots with the way we plan our meals and stuff? That alone will solve way more problems than this whole, like, you know, let's eliminate cattle and start growing different foods, which is way more complicated, way more difficult to do.
Right. Stop being so wasteful. Just,
that's
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Literally, if everybody was 10% less wasteful, you would get we would make way more headway mm-hmm. than eliminating all the cows on the
Dude,
earth.
It also reminds me totally. Of these celebrities who go and preach about how, you know, you guys, your carbon footprint is too high. And
hop on your private jet.
And they're flying around on their
so
private
great.
Jet.
So
with
awesome.
One
and
trip,
their yacht.
One yeah. trip on their private jet will make
Dumping
more
oil in the ocean.
Well, it's a bigger carbon footprint than I can produce my whole life with my car with one
yeah.
flight.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's just the hypocrisy is just fucking, it's infuriating.
It is
so,
funny they missed that.
Yeah, so that's the stance right there.
But I think
now that we've pissed everybody off.
Well, no, and of course, I'm sure it's a vegan who's asking the question. We promote you know, eating vegan once a week. I think it's a great way
it's
to eat. Yeah, I think it's healthy to do that. I definitely don't think it's a healthy way to have a lifestyle, though. Unless you are, I mean, super dialed. And if you are super dialed,
it takes a lot of planning.
It does. It takes a lot of planning. It's in, and then you have to
and
be,
you have to supplement,
right? Yeah. So I mean, if you're okay with that lifestyle and you like it, then more power to you. But I definitely am not going to become a promoter of something that I think is more challenging. I think people have a hard enough time eating right or making good choices for their body. If you limit that too, and you make it even more challenging for them, we're not going to have more success.
The future of food production isn't in producing more food; it's in our distribution of how we provide that food to people, how to get it to people without a lot of it going bad,
how to give
people opportunities to be more prosperous so they can purchase food.
Let's eliminate preservatives and see what happens.
Yeah, it's in production is not the problem. We have a lot of, we make a lot of fucking food.
I think we're going to start going backwards. I think we're going to have more and more people will start growing their own stuff, yeah. I think.
Sure.
I think that, I think you're going to see, I mean, I know I want to. I know that's one of my things is I want to have a property where I can pretty much live off my land for the most part.
That makes a lot of sense.
I think eventually prices will get so ridiculous in order to have it, to know it's clean sourced and all these things, that eventually you'll just be like, honey, this is ridiculous. Instead of us putting a garage for our car that we don't drive anymore.
Meanwhile, the industry's trying to come up with some kind of genetically like created meat that's just meat. You bypass the animal in completely. Now it's like, oh, well, there's no conflict with this meat, right? It's just grown.
I'm sure at some point they'll figure out how to make synthetic food that's good for you. They're nowhere near figuring that out yet, so don't try it. But at some point, science should catch up.
Lifeless food. It doesn't make sense.
We'll see about that.
All right.
Check it out. Go to YouTube. Subscribe to our fitness channel. It's Mind Pump TV. We post a new video every single day. You got to see the latest one that was up there. I think it was like how to set up your bench press.
We just had Jordan Shallow in the studio. Always dropping great information.
Awesome video. Also, you heard us talk about 30 days of coaching earlier. You can get it for free. It's at mindpumpmedia.com.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.